everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel here on YouTube. Today we are going to talk about something very interesting about investing in a specific class of assets. I have mentioned in several previous videos that I'm interested in this class of assets. I'm not yet invested in this class of assets. But before we start with the video, I would just like to ask you to subscribe to my channel and to hit the bell notification button. This way you will never miss an update on my site. I'm posting them quite regularly on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays. You should expect new videos from me. And the two asset, let's say, classes that I have previously mentioned that I'm interested in getting to know more about them and potentially to invest in them. One was the precious metals and things like this, but we are not going to talk about them today. We are going to talk about the other class, which are the real estate investment trusts or REITs. And the idea is that somehow I have the feeling that I'm not diversified enough, meaning that I have a clear preference for the stock exchanges, for the shares. I used to own also some bonds, some investment funds, listed and non-listed. I still have some other investments like insurance with LinkedIn, so unit linked. So with like an investment plan, I have a policy and insurance with a cash value at the end. I have presented both of them, and you can find the videos right now. I'm posting them. And so the idea is how to try to diversify. I'm not a very big fan of investing in cryptocurrencies. So the idea was somehow to try to invest also in real estate. It's quite difficult because by real estate there are not that many options, there are many options, but not that many classes. You can either buy something or property, which can be either an apartment, a house, can be some land, can be some industrial facilities, it doesn't really matter. The idea is that for most of the people this is only achievable through mortgage, so by taking debt, so taking a loan from a bank or from any other financial institution. And the other opportunity is to invest in these REITs. I have explained also several times, the real estate investment trusts are a real estate meets investment fund meets stock exchange, if they are listed on stock exchange. So they function exactly like an investment fund, just that they are further investing in real estate. Some of them are also listed on the stock exchanges, so you can say that they are also very similar to it with shares. Let's just jump right in. So the problem that is that investing in real estate is a social matter as well. Think about it. If you invest in shares, so on stock exchange, if you buy gold, if you buy Pokemon cards, if you buy whatever you buy in this direction, you are not affecting anyone. Yeah. However, if you are investing in real estate, it's like, from my point of view, it's like at some point somebody who's got a lot of money, or maybe several people, decide to buy all the food in the world, and then many people will starve to death because they will no longer have access to food, or the food will be so expensive as these owners decide the prices because they control all the food and so on and so forth. So this is the same problem with the real estate that I have noticed since a long, long time ago, especially in 2008 and 2009, when we had this bubble in the real estate markets all over the place, and especially in the United States. And what happened is that the more people are interested in investing, the more the prices are growing, and that can be a problem for other people. If we start seeing the, let's say, housing, it's a social problem as well, and it cannot be regulated only by investing. So somehow these things are contradicting. Also, I realize that I'm quite on the good track with these assumptions and the way I see things, because recently in Berlin, the 56% of the population voted in a referendum to have the real estate giants, so the large companies that own property in Berlin, so housing, to be expropriated because they can no longer live. I have heard of situations when the rent is making up to 75% of somebody's monthly income, and they claim that these companies are responsible for the ever increase in prices or in real estate, so the inflation, so the increases in rents. And truth be told, before this video, I made another one about Gen Y and Gen Z, so the, let's say, the generations after 1981, in which I'm somehow included, so I'm on the border, let's say, that they have troubles with capitalism, and one of the problems they were claiming there was this housing issue, that the rents are very expensive compared with the monthly income that they can get no matter what they are doing in their professional lives, and acquiring an apartment or a house is such a far-fetched dream for many of them that they have lost trust in capitalism and in market economy and things like this. So the alternative, the first alternative, which is considered by many, is to just buy an apartment or a house. I have in several videos explained that this can be considered as an investment, because after you pay your mortgage, you'll get the benefits in the terms that you will no longer need to pay mortgage, of course, if the mortgage is already paid, but you will also no longer need to pay rent to somebody else, so that would be your benefit. And the idea is that if you enter in a mortgage contract, or so you buy a house or an apartment for yourself, the sooner you do it, the better. If you are doing it too late, then you risk after these 30 years, after paying your mortgage, of not having too many years left for having also the benefits of your investment, let's say. So it will be an investment with benefits for the next generation. So if you have kids or things like, so somebody or any other relative can benefit from your investment, let's say. I'm saying that, okay, if you want to own something else than just stocks, it's a good way of diversifying. The problem with buying property is that you need to make a substantial advance payment, the long-term mortgage up to 30 years, and you need to commit yourself to the property, even if you don't live inside it, and you are somehow tied to that specific town or city. You still have obligations, even if it's a rental property and you rent it to a tenant, you still have obligations and repairing and maintaining it and so on and so forth. Also, the idea that you are buying only one house or only one apartment, it's not really that diversified, so it's going against the diversification, and you cannot diversify that much, because that would mean to have several properties in maybe several cities or locations, countries, and so on and so forth. And also, you will have problems with liquidity, meaning that it's not that easy to get out of an investment property, so out of a house just to sell it, or an apartment to get out of the mortgage, and so on and so forth. So if you really need money very fast and you need to somehow transform that in cash, you will be in trouble, let's say, for at least on short term. The houses don't sell that easily. And I have also seen many, I have seen many failed investments, people that bought land somewhere because they were coming from that region, they didn't know what they wanted to do with it, they didn't do anything. Sometimes they even took credits for buying that piece of land. A lot of houses built, apartments acquired in areas with, where there are no tenants available, the rents are not increasing, the prices of the properties are not increasing, the regions are getting depopulated, and so on and so forth. So it's quite an investment which you should watch, what kind of investment you are doing and where you are doing it, because the events that will happen in that region in the next 5, 10, 20 years will affect you as well, and it's a very long-term commitment. And as a solution, I have found this REITs, this real estate investment trust, through which you can somehow link yourself with the real estate market and try to wrap some of the benefits. Just a word of warning, today's presentation will be just the first in a series, because there are so many things to tackle, and I have made this decision of presenting you the steps which I'm taking in order to reach to some potential good investments. And you will see also the troubles that I'm getting to by researching the information in on the internet and so on and so forth, because I think that can also be very valuable for yourself. I could have come with a cleaned list with after many hours of work and show you like, okay, these are the rates in which I decided to invest. They have these PE ratios, this potential growth, this dividend yield and so on and so forth. And if you want to invest in rates, maybe these are a good idea and thank you, goodbye. But I think there is so much more to see in this type of approach that I'm doing, because it will, and I have previously discovered in the previous video about when I was doing the research about TSMC, I have discovered that the public financial information sources, Yahoo Finance and other YouTubers use this as well, like Yahoo Finance, MSN, now I will add some others to the list. You need to be very careful with the information there and to try to check it from multiple sources and to see if that's really correct. So the REITs function as an investment fund, so they take money from several people and then they invest it further. They have the same diversification as investment advantages as an investment fund, so diversification, so lower risk, because they own more property, not only one object. And they have specialists that know the market and how it is that functioning and what kind of value that have the properties in which they invest and so on and so forth. However, the drawback is that you need to pay for the specialist, so you have to pay for the middleman, but that's also valid for the investment funds. Now, from what kind of type of rates we have equity rates, so that own objects, mortgage rates that actually are giving mortgages, and hybrids. And then you can have, of course, private, in which you cannot get, so more or less they are owned by several people or only one guy that's just administering his own company. Then you have public non-traded, they are more or less like the investment funds which are not traded, and potentially they might have the benefit of having a price for the unit which is better linked with the value of their investments and what they are actually doing as activity. And because, let's say at some point some Yahoo decides that he wants to sell the his stake in a public traded, so on the stock exchange there is this public traded rate, and he decides to sell it to buy some, I don't know, some Shiba Inu or something crazy like that, and the price of your okay, you can buy the dip, is always, if the prices go down it's always a good opportunity to invest. But however, if you already own units in this trust, the value of them will go down, and somehow that has nothing to do with the underlying performance of the assets that these REITs are administering. There are several sectors, and according to S&P classification, so I found the classification, I have found several. So you have tower means that it's a structure on which is built like a tower, and on which other companies can put antenna, so it can be radio, television, mobile phones and so on and so forth. You have industrial, data center, residential, self-storage, mortgage, net lease is not sector related, it's actually a specific type of lease, meaning that the REIT has absolutely no obligation into managing the property. Of course, they are not getting that much rent, but they don't need to pay the taxes for the property, they don't need to pay insurance or to do the maintenance. It's a special condition contract. Then you have healthcare, office, timber is also related with the property around exploiting and selling of timber, so it's an industry specific. And then you have retail. And for each of these, you might have some subsectors like manufactured homes. So for residentials, you can have apartments, strip centers, that is more like in the let's say in the retail, malls as well. So in retail, factory outlets, also retail meets somehow industrial, and hotels separate, also probably from the super sector would be like in the residential, or maybe they need to be in a separate class by themselves. Then very simple, I said that I'm way too much exposed to the United States, I want to do something here in Europe, and I said, okay, there is this STOXX Europe 600, which is like the S&P 500 in the United States, so it should be an index which is relevant and contains 600 different titles, so 600 different assets from Europe. And of course that within it is a real estate section. There are index funds which are following, because then the problem would be solved. It would be very easy. You would just buy this. But there are 9 funds, three from Lyxor, Xtrackers has one, 2 from BNP Paribas, Invesco and Amundi, according to justetf.com. There are 9 index funds which are tracking this STOXX Europe 600, but there is none that tracks the real estate within the STOXX Europe 600. So, yeah. However, according to a website which I'm just going to show you immediately, I have found that there are 28 REITs included from countries such as Sweden, Germany, UK, Netherlands, Switzerland, France, Belgium, Austria and Spain. Actually, I have discovered later that there are other countries, and I started looking at the metrics. And I saw that they have somehow a market capitalization between 500 million and 102 billion, PE ratios between 5.13 and 73.57. And when I noticed that 15 of them, so from 28, 15 of them had no price to earnings ratio. Usually you have that when the company doesn't have any earnings, so it's on a loss. I started asking myself if that could be really the case, that they have included in such a an index, they had included so many companies that don't have earnings. And also according to this, the revenues were between 70.1 million and 22.5 billion. And what also drew the attention for me was that the most expensive ones, so the ones which were in the range of 100, 120 billion, were from Sweden. Sweden has its own currency. And I started thinking that maybe I get the same error, that actually the local currency of Sweden is not converted to euro in order to be able to compare it with countries like Germany and France and so on and so forth, or the UK values are not converted from Great British Pound to euro and so on and so forth. And then I have really discovered that it's yet another, after MSN and Yahoo Finance, this investing.com, which offered me this list of the selection of rates within the STOXX 600, that is also not reliable. I have decided to expand the analysis and to convert the numbers. So all these numbers that you have seen before, these market caps, the PE ratios, the revenues and things like this, I have decided to completely ignore it, ignore them. And here you have the list of companies. Actually, you see that the 122 billion one and all the first 4 ones are from Sweden. Then on the 5th place from market capitalization point of view is the Vonovia from Germany and so on and so forth. But I don't trust the PE ratios. You see the many PE ratios for these companies are missing. It seems unlikely that that's true. And the idea was that, okay, I either start checking all of them and add the correct market capitalizations, revenues, PE ratios and betas for all of them. But I'm also not interested in all the countries. So my decision was to go for the largest countries, meaning the United Kingdom, Germany and France, from this list. And what I have done is that I have checked the list because I already didn't trust the numbers. I said that, like, okay, let's see, maybe also the companies are not right. From Germany, we had on this list from investing.com, we had Vonovia, Deutsche Wohnen, Legimobilien and Deutsche Euroshop AG. It proved out that Deutsche Euroshop AG is not actually a part of STOXX 600. I checked it with iShares. If you remember, iShares is one of the company which issues an index fund based on STOXX 600, and also with stocks.com, so that I'm sure. So Deutsche Euroshop is not really a part of this index, so I took it out. What was also interesting about Deutsche Euroshop, which should have told me that something is wrong, it's the relative low market capitalization, so 1.07 billion. Then from France, we got Gecina, Covivio and Klépierre. Icade proved not to be on the list. From UK, From investing.com, we have Segro Land Securities, British Land Company, Derwen, and then there are four others which are not really part of STOXX 600, so Shaftesbury, Great Portland Estates, Hammerson Capital and Counties. Then I also looked in the on the iShares.com and on stock.com and have decided to add, because they are really part of STOXX 600, Alstria office for Germany, around town, Grand City Properties, which is very interesting because it seems it's from Luxembourg but is considered to be part of Germany, and Tag Immobilien. For UK I have Assura, Derwent London, Big Yellow Group, Londometric Property, Tritax, Big Box, Rightmove, Primary Health Properties, and from France, Unibail, Rodamoco. And this is how I came up with the, let's say so far, with the list of real estate companies which are in these specific three countries. So real estate investment trusts which are in specific in these specific three countries, Germany, UK and France, and which are potentially interested in, for me. And now I need to somehow find the financials for this and to see what kind of market capitalization they actually have, what kind of PE ratio, some PEG ratio, maybe some price to sales. I also need to look at this free operating cash flow, which is more relevant than the PE for real estate investment trust. And then I should be able to select several of them which are fit for investing, but however, you see how difficult it is to just do something which seems very simple. Okay, you open some websites and you think that you at least you will get the right companies and the numbers will be correct, and that your thinking should be about the numbers and not if the numbers are correct or if those companies are in that specific index and so on and so forth. So I think that's also very valuable for you to see the errors that appear. I have also presented several errors from the Yahoo Finance and from MSN in the video about TSMC. Basically, when we were talking about TSMC, on MSN I discovered that the share prices are in dollars, which is okay, but all the financials were in Taiwanese currency. Then, and also for the Yahoo Finance, it made absolutely no sense, but it was also very easy to lead you to mistake, because you're looking at a market capitalization of $500 billion, and next to it was a 1.2 trillion revenue, and you are thinking that a 0.36 price to sales ratio is correct. But then I figured it out that actually 1.2 trillion was in Taiwanese currency, so in Taiwanese dollar and not in the US dollar. And you see, then I was asking myself how come it has such a low price to sales ratio, but the price to earnings ratio is 22. That means that for so much sales, the earnings are very low. But then I was looking at the net margin, and the net margin was very high. So you see this kind of thinking, which made me discover that these information sources are not 100% reliable and not all the time. Of course, in the next episode of talking about REITs, we will go through this list and see what kind of financials and ratios each and every one of these, and we will also add some more of these REITs has, and we will also add some more criteria, like for example, you have guessed right, I don't really want to go into housing REITs, so into the ones that are providing houses for the people and so on, because of the social concerns that I have, and yeah, especially not in Berlin. So this was the presentation for today. I look forward to presenting to you next time. It will be also about REITs, so the continuation of this video. Please do not forget to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button if you liked what you see, to like the video, to share it with somebody that might be interested about it, and to comment if you have something to add to the conversation. Also below this video we have several links. One is gives you the opportunity to create an eToro account where you can trade without a commission or a fee, which is always a saving. Two, Amazon securities, Amazon links, not securities, two Amazon links. With one you can get two free Audibles or two free audiobooks. The other one gives you access to the Kindle program if you like reading electronic books. And last but not least, there is a wish list with hardware and software items which can help me improve the quality of my videos and should also be beneficial, very beneficial for you. It's not a very convenient this wish list. The most convenient way through which you can support me is just to subscribe to my channel and to keep watching my videos. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. This is my finance and accounting education channel here on YouTube. I thank you for your time and I wish you goodbye.